Good. I think we have all the technology put together now. Not sure I'm being mic'd though. Can you hear me back there? When we when I turned on my mic, it cut you out, and that's why I turned mine back on again. I wonder if you need to turn it on again, weirdly, and see if that does that improve things at all. It shouldn't. You wouldn't think it would. But when you were speaking and I turned this on, it cut out your mic.
Cut this one off.
But now I'm check. Can you hear me at the back all right? Those of you who want to, at least. Okay, so we'll go ahead in faith that that will be sufficient. And if it isn't, you just wave at me and I will probably do nothing at all. But I will try if I can do something for it. In our present cultural moment, when pairs of qualities normally held in respectful and creative tension, the simple and the complex, the basic and the sophisticated, the individual and the corporate, the intuitive and the rational, the central and the peripheral, the rural and the urban, the traditional and the modern, the momentous and the quotidian, even the left and the right, when such obvious complements instead are polarized into mutually unintelligible and antagonistic rivals, we might do well to take an evening to consider a mind and an ethic, a way of being in the world, capacious enough to embrace them all. In the name of the Creator who made and loves them all. So let's consider the mind and the basic approach to life, the ethos or ethic of C.S. Lewis. And we'll plunge in as Lewis himself, a Christian lover of stories, scholar of stories, and composer of stories, might begin with his understanding of the Christian story. The Christian Bible includes a wide range of genres, but as a whole, it has a distinctly narrative shape. It has a beginning, creation, a plot complication, the fall, a middle, salvation, and an end, consummation. Let's begin then with creation. C.S. Lewis follows the Genesis account in understanding the world to have been created good, but also as immature. The world thus leans forward, so to speak, to its future, to its cultivation and maturation and fulfillment. Quoting Lewis, "We ask how the nature created by a good God comes to be in this condition, by which question we may mean either how she comes to be imperfect, to leave room for improvement, as the schoolmasters say in their reports, or else how she comes to be positively departed. If we ask the question in the first sense, the Christian answer, I think, is that God, from the first, created her such as to reach her perfection by a process in time. He made an earth at first without form and void, and brought it by degrees to its perfection. And in that sense, a certain degree of evolutionism or developmentalism is inherent to Christianity." Unquote. We might note in this regard that Adam and Eve themselves were morally innocent, but not morally mature. Relatively unformed and unconfirmed in habits of righteousness as they were free to sin in a way that a morally mature individual, angel or human, is not, because that mature individual's deeply formed character inclines firmly away from sin and toward goodness. Moral reality, for Lewis, is as real a part of this world as its physicality. He argues for this view at length in The Abolition of Man, particularly in terms of a great way of the world, morally speaking, which he discerned in the widespread moral consensus of civilizations. To label this consensus, he borrowed the Chinese word Dao, or way, and provided an appendix of similar moral maxims culled from the scriptures of the world's great religions. Morality, thus, is not merely a matter of social convention, nor simply of biological impetus, but is part of the very structure of things, to defy which is as foolish and harmful as to defy the force of gravity or the power of electricity. And thus the moral imperative simply stems from the moral indicative. You ought not to do this because that's the way things are. Quoting him now, "This thing which I have called for convenience the Tao, and which others may call natural law or traditional morality or the first principles of practical reason or the first platitudes, is not one among a series of possible systems of value. It is the sole source of all value judgments. There never has been and never will be a radically new judgment of value in the history of the world." Lewis drew an important lesson from this moral realism. He asserted that moral education is highly useful, while moral exhortation generally isn't. This was before he was a parent. Either people see reality and act accordingly, including moral reality, or they don't. Either someone understands enough about electricity not to cross the red and white wires, or he doesn't understand and proceeds in confident ignorance that what he's doing is right. Pleading with him to stop might work for the moment if he is moved by your anguish and doesn't want it to continue, but if you want him never to cross the wires, pleading isn't the solution. Teaching him about electricity is. Lewis understood the perversity of the human heart better than most. The Screwtape Letters makes that clear. And Lewis recognized that some people will defy good teaching and proceed to destruction out of foolish conceit. As a lifelong educator, he had no illusions that education was the panacea for human ills. He simply indicated something fundamental about moral formation. Showing people the way things are and then showing them how to negotiate that reality successfully is a better way to encourage goodness than mere exhortation from whatever position of authority or sympathy one happens to enjoy. Just as understanding and then contending well with physical reality is not always a simple matter, however, so it is that moral training is required as well. One can sit in a classroom and be correctly informed about the nature of gravity, friction, snow, and so on, but the skill of negotiating the physical reality of a mountainside on skis must be learned only with exertion and perseverance. So too, moral training means inculcating, fostering, and confirming moral habits over time with similar exertion and perseverance. Thus, Lewis affirms that moral education as both rigorous and sustained, again, especially in the abolition of man. The summum bonum of human existence for Lewis is shown us in Eden and its portrait of nascent shalom, a condition in which each individual thing is fully and healthily itself, and in which it enjoys peaceful, wholesome, and delightful relations with God, with itself, and with all of the rest of creation. Secondly, the fall. Few writers have exposed the nature of human and indeed diabolical evil better than C.S. Lewis. Dostoevsky, Balzac, Dickens, O'Connor, and other great novelists have painted their great canvases of debauchery, decadence, and destruction. But Lewis was a master in bringing to light what we might call everyday evil, the ordinary ways in which people torment and exploit each other, harm themselves, and cooperate, willingly or not, with nefarious spiritual powers. In the light of this clear-eyed view of sin, Lewis writes, quote, Our leisure, even our play, is a matter of serious concern. There is no neutral ground in the universe. Every square inch, every split second, is claimed by God and counterclaimed by Satan." End quote. Lewis thus made clear that education, no matter how rigorous or sustained, will not suffice to solve our deep and broad moral afflictions. Our sinful condition, a fundamental derangement of appetite, attitude, and outlook, makes it not just difficult, but finally impossible to improve enough to warrant God's approbation. We are thus exiled from Eden, from the companionship of God and the delight of a properly functioning world, to wander in wilderness instead. Then, salvation. Virtue can become a passion for us only as we are indeed born again. Thus, Lewis notes often, the Bible and Christian tradition is replete with imagery of death and resurrection, or new birth by the power of God. Lewis never tires of this theme, that new life, which we all need, requires death of a sort. The gospel paradox of losing one's life to save it, Matthew 10:39, is perhaps the most quoted scriptural phrase in Lewis's corpus. Quoting, "Christ says, 'Give me all. I don't want so much of your time and so much of your money and so much of your work. I want you. I have not come to torment your natural self, but to kill it. No half measures are any good. I don't want to cut off a branch here and a branch there. I want to have the whole tree down. I don't want to drill the tooth or crown it or stop it, but to have it out. Hand over the whole natural self, all the desires which you think innocent as well as the ones you think wicked, the whole outfit." Unquote. Yet the paradox deepens. Grace perfects nature, Lewis declares, and elsewhere he says, quote, "All that you are, sins apart, is destined, if you will let God have his good way, to utter satisfaction." Unquote. What we are reborn to, then, is not a negation of everything we felt and enjoyed and wanted before. This new life is but a purification and elevation of all that we love that is good to its shining best. Lewis puts it this way in his book called Miracles, quote, "The first innocent and spontaneous desires have to submit to the death-like process of control or total denial. But from that, there is a reascent to fully formed character in which the strength of the original material all operates, but in a new way. Death and rebirth go down to go up. It's a key principle. Through this bottleneck, this belittlement, the high road nearly always lies." Unquote. So, eros is completed but not negated by agape. So also bios, our natural life, is taken up into what Lewis calls our spiritual life of zoe. Thus we encounter the continuity-discontinuity question. How much of our new life in Christ is to be undertaken properly in continuity with what was before, and how much in discontinuity? How new is new? Gilbert Milander, an unusually perspicacious interpreter of Lewis, and I think one of my predecessors in this lectureship, puts our experience of the tension between the old and the new this way, quoting Milander. "Existentially, we experience not a harmony, but a rivalry between our love for God and our natural loves. The pictures of the natural loves, harmoniously perfected by divine love, must never blind our eyes to what this may mean in any person's experience. It may mean conflict, rivalry, renunciation, and grief. For a fallen creature to turn to God will seem like a death of the self. It cannot be experienced simply as a turning from one good to a higher good, but instead must often be experienced as a negation, not only of the thing, but of the self." Unquote. Lewis thus speaks of nature wounded by grace, but as a dentist or surgeon hurts in order to heal. It is this view of redemption that prompted Lewis occasionally to defend the prospect of purgatory, an intermediate state in which believers are purged of their remaining impurities and made ready to enjoy the life to come. And the dominant mode of response to God's initiative in salvation for Lewis is in the Christian tradition of the imitatio Christi, the imitation of Christ. Now, to be sure, faith, as both assent to the truth of Christian teaching and trust in the person of Christ as Savior, is central to Lewis's religion. But it seems fair to say that the theme of sanctification was more dominant in Lewis than justification. Faith typically is portrayed by him as lived commitment. It originates, though, in divine regeneration, not merely in our good intentions. The committed life, furthermore, has a trajectory. It's headed for a particular destination, and it makes progress toward that goal step by step. The discipline of the Christian walk is hard. Indeed, it requires a kind of death and a daily willingness to march toward death as one shoulders one's cross in the train of the crucified one. Preparation for the eventual great dance requires discipline. Quote, "Discipline, while the world is yet unfallen, exists for the sake of what seems its very opposite, for freedom, almost for extravagance. The heavenly frolic arises from an orchestra which is in tune. The rules of courtesy make perfect ease and freedom possible between those who obey them." Unquote. This severe renunciation is yet accompanied by deep enjoyment. God strews our way with pleasures. Pleasures affirm to us the goodness of God, the goodness of the world, the goodness of each other, and the goodness of ourselves. Pleasures draw us out from ourselves to this larger cosmos and finally to God Himself. Lewis makes this point powerfully in the mouth of the authoritative demon Screwtape. Quote, "God is a hedonist at heart. All those fasts and vigils and stakes and crosses are only a facade, only like foam on the seashore. Out at sea, out in his sea, there's pleasure and more pleasure. He makes no secret of it. At his right hand are pleasures forevermore. Ugh. I don't think he is the least inkling of that high and austere mystery to which we rise in the miserific vision. He's vulgar, Wormwood. He has a bourgeois mind. He has filled his world full of pleasures. There are things for humans to do all day long without his minding in the least. Sleeping, washing, eating, drinking, making love, playing, praying, working. Horror." End quote. Yet the switchbacks in Lewis's thought continue. There is fundamentally a choice to be a pleasure seeker, thus drawing the world into oneself, devouring it and shrinking it at the same time, as Satan is depicted in Screwtape as the supreme and shrinking narcissist, or to be a God seeker, and so one is drawn outside oneself into the world to enjoy it, and God, and oneself fully and forever. As Mylander puts it, Lewis commends to us the attitude of receptivity, a freedom both to receive anything gratefully from God and to just as freely relinquish anything back to God. What then of culture and of our everyday lives in the world? Lewis addresses Christianity and culture in just one essay, directly. It was not a theme to which he turned often. And he seems to have had in mind here mostly the definition of culture as high culture, particularly intellectual and aesthetic activity, although he does relate this plane to the other levels of human life. Lewis begins by referring to his own study of the Bible on this question, and particularly the attitude of the New Testament. Quote, "Here I found a demand that whatever is most highly valued on the natural level is to be held, as it were, merely on sufferance, and to be abandoned without mercy the moment it conflicts with the service of God." Lewis continues, "On the whole, the New Testament seemed, if not hostile, yet unmistakably cold to culture. I think we can still believe culture to be innocent after we've read the New Testament, but I can't see that we're encouraged to think it important." End quote. Now, by saying that culture can be innocent, Lewis seems to mean that it can still be seen as a good thing to be undertaken and not necessarily something evil to be avoided. But particularly for a man whose profession it was to teach literature to privileged students in a great university, Lewis sets out an intriguing list of four reasons why culture of this sort can be a proper undertaking. Here's his list of four. First, the need to earn a living. It's hard to write poems about that, but that's what he says. That's first, the need to earn a living. Secondly, culture can be harmful, so, quote, "it's therefore probably better that the ranks of the culture sellers should include some Christians as an antidote." Third, pleasure. Fourth, to awaken the unconverted to the something more that points toward the gospel. Now, it seems to me that while there's nothing objectionable on this list, it's also curiously bereft of any missional purpose at all beyond evangelism. There are no mentions here of the so-called creation mandate of Genesis 1, to fill the earth and subdue it, to cultivate the world as the primary calling of all humanity. Now, Lewis does notice something of the importance of that theme, to be sure. As converted people, he says, we ought to do our work, quote, "unto the Lord," unquote, to glorify him thereby. Quoting again Lewis, "the work of a Beethoven and the work of a charwoman become spiritual on precisely the same condition, that of being offered to God, of being done humbly as to the Lord," end quote. In sum, then, Lewis says, quoting again, culture, though not in itself meritorious, was innocent and pleasant, might be a vocation for some, was helpful in bringing certain souls to Christ, and could be pursued to the glory of God, end quote. Again, however, we must note that what Lewis means by bringing glory to God in our world is not spelled out, a curious lapse for an author who is normally so explicit. This is not the only remarkable lacuna in Lewis's posture toward society, however. Lewis's focus almost always rests on the sphere of the individual life, Christian or otherwise. It helps give his writing its remarkably intimate appeal. But when one steps out of that almost cozy chat one is having with Lewis as one reads, one realizes that Lewis has relatively little to say about either church life or about society as a whole. He loves Holy Communion, but one imagines him going, receiving it, and leaving. His Cambridge acquaintance, Richard Ladbrokes, comments, quote, "Neither in conversation nor in his works did he show much interest in organized religion. He was orthodox in belief, but seemed to have little sense of the church," unquote. His learned clerical friend, Alan Bede Griffiths, remarks also on Lewis's, quote, "almost total lack of concern about the church as an institution," unquote. Likewise, we might ask what Lewis thought about cities, those symbols of human social life. Wesley Court writes, quote, "While Lewis affirms the importance of social spaces that accommodate and stimulate the potentials of persons and grant to persons a sense of being a home, he offers no realistic models of social space equivalent to those he gives for personal spaces and open landscapes," unquote. Compare also the testimonial of Helen Gardner. Quote, "Despite the fact that much of his academic work concerned the debt of English literature to the literature of the Renaissance, no vision of cities, large and small, with splendid public monuments, ever played a large role in his imagination. For Lewis, the simple loyalties of the comitatus were never replaced by the more complex loyalties of the city. End quote. Sounding every bit the embattled but faithful individual pilgrim in a hostile and misguided society, Lewis advises, quote, "The main practical task for most of us is not to give the big men advice about how to end our fatal economy. We have none to give, and they wouldn't listen. But to consider how we can live within it as little hurt and degraded as possible." End quote. Furthermore, Lewis affirms a principle of difference, or even what sociologists of modernity would call differentiation, in one's vocation that contributes toward the common good. He characterizes himself as a literary scholar, cultural critic, and apologist, and not as a political theorist or as a clergyman. Quote, "Of forms of government, of civil authority and civil obedience, I've nothing to say." End quote. That is, for Lewis, each of us plows his or her own furrow, and the field gets done. Or more precisely, each of us plays his or her role in the complex interactions of modern society, and all benefit. Quoting him again, "The application of Christian principles, say, to trade unionism or education, must come from Christian trade unionists and Christian schoolmasters, just as Christian literature comes from Christian novelists and dramatists, not from the bench of bishops getting together and trying to write plays and novels in their spare time." End quote. So we should hardly fault C.S. Lewis, among the most versatile of authors, for not remarking extensively on political matters as well, but he remains in his thinking largely an individual in a complex and generally hostile world. Still, his broad vision extends, as Christian vision must extend, beyond all such penultimate matters to the world to come. And so the consummation. I'm tempted to give myself a little comic relief by saying this is actually a very rare photograph of C.S. Lewis. but it isn't. It isn't. It's just an illustration. Consummation. Lewis has sometimes been called a Platonist, and we shall examine at least one way in which that characterization makes sense. But his fundamental view of the world to come is not Platonic. Indeed, it differs from most of his beloved medieval and Renaissance authors in that the goal of human life is not merely the beatific vision. Quoting Lewis, "The promises of Scripture may very roughly be reduced to five heads. It is promised, firstly, that we shall be with Christ. Secondly, that we shall be like him. Thirdly, and with an enormous wealth of imagery, that we shall have glory. Fourthly, that we shall in some sense be fed or feasted or entertained. And finally, that we shall have some sort of official position in the universe, ruling cities, judging angels, being pillars of God's temple." End quote. Now, Lewis can sound Platonic, particularly in the recurring motif of radical disruption. Quote, "The doctrine of the second coming is deeply uncongenial to the whole evolutionary or developmental character of modern thought. We've been taught to think of the world as something that grows slowly toward perfection, something that progresses or evolves, but Christian apocalyptic offers us no such hope. It foretells a sudden, violent end imposed from without. An extinguisher popped onto the candle. A brick flung at the gramophone." For those of you younger, that would be at the CD player. "A curtain rung down on the play. Halt." Unquote. Now, while this disruption is itself radical, it's not as comprehensively destructive as Lewis's images suggest. Quote, "The New Testament account of Christ's resurrection and ascension is not the picture of an escape from any and every kind of nature into some unconditioned and utterly transcendent life. It is the picture of a new human nature and a new nature in general being brought into existence, We must indeed believe the risen body to be extremely different from the mortal body, but the existence in that new state of anything that could in any sense be described as body at all involves some sort of spatial relations, and in the long run, a whole new universe. Now that's the picture, he says, not of unmaking, but of remaking. The old field of space, time, matter, and the senses is to be weeded, dug, and sown for a new crop. We may be tired of that old field. God is not. Unquote. Lewis uses the image of a house to nicely show the ambiguity of this theme of continuity and discontinuity. A new nature is being not merely made, but made out of an old one. We live amid all the anomalies, inconveniences, hopes, and excitements of a house that is being rebuilt. Something is being pulled down, and something simultaneously is going up in its place. End quote. Now, one might well ask of Lewis, now, is something being remade or replaced? I suspect he would reply, both. Out of the one comes the other, with resemblance, but also transcendence. Just like Jesus' resurrection body, which is our one glimpse of the new creation physically, so to speak, beyond John's visions in the Apocalypse. With such a view of what's to come, Lewis celebrates Sehnsucht, his longing for joy. This longing, he says, is vital to our well-being as it keeps us from settling for what cannot satisfy and draws us upward and forward to the new world in which all is finally well. His most popular sermon furnishes us with this oft-quoted observation. Quote, if we consider the unblushing promises of reward and the staggering nature of the rewards promised in the Gospels, it would seem that our Lord finds our desires not too strong, but too weak. We are half-hearted creatures, fooling about with drink and sex and ambition when infinite joy is offered us, like an ignorant child who wants to go on making mud pies in a slum because he can't imagine what it's meant by the offer of a holiday at the sea. We are far, he says, too easily pleased. End quote. So let's, having traversed this story, draw together now some focus, some themes from the foregoing into an understanding of Lewis's basic ethics, his basic understanding of how to be in the world. Starting with sanctification of the self and society. We've seen that Lewis emphasizes particularly the model of the individual Christian faithfully making his way along the path of sanctification, looking for the world to come, taking pleasure as he finds it, and contributing to the common good as he can. Inasmuch as the cumulative influence of Christians in a society affects public institutions, however, Lewis's concern was not to subvert public institutions, nor to convert them to their final messianic state, but to revert them back to their traditional sources and purposes in God's providence. In this view, Lewis was a cultural conservative, not merely reactionary or contrarian, not because he entertained any romantic view of the inherent goodness of society at some point in the past, but in the deep sense of one who continues to see the goodness and order of God over and in all earthly affairs. Lewis had not given up on the structures God has placed in the world, and he believed that the Christian is to contribute as he can to any attempt to recover these healthful, helpful gifts. That was the positive side of his conservatism. There was a negative side as well. Quote, being a Democrat, I am opposed to all drastic and sudden changes of society in whatever direction, because they never in fact take place except by a particular technique, and that technique involves the seizure of power by a small, highly disciplined group of people. The terror and the secret police follow, it would seem, automatically. And I do not think that any group is good enough to have such power. They are men of like passions with ourselves, unquote. Realism, as well as hope, therefore, constantly tempered Lewis's outlook. He himself found it natural to think in terms of hierarchy, believing that it was ultimately the correct order of things. And this disposition accounts at least partly for why he was so at home in the Middle Ages, particularly in its imaginative literature. But when it came to the actual political life of human beings in his own time, Lewis recommends democracy, not hierarchy, because of the fall. He says, "The real reason for democracy is that we are so fallen that no one can be trusted with unchecked power over his fellows." Unquote. I'm glad to say that that seems to have no relevance to any contemporary events I can imagine at all. Finally, Lewis sees redemption for nature herself. Quote, "She, like ourselves, is to be redeemed. She will be cured in character, not tamed, heaven forbid, nor sterilized." End quote. So again, while Lewis focuses most of his attention on human beings and on individual human beings, his vision does extend well beyond ourselves to the whole world under God's care. Secondly, evangelism as the chief mission and yet scholarship also as worthy occupation. Lewis had a strong evangelistic concern. He spent considerable time speaking and writing in the hopes of drawing his embattled and discouraged countrymen and women to a vital faith. Yet he recognized that most Christians are called to spend most of their time in activity that isn't obviously and directly evangelistic. Quote, "Before I became a Christian, I do not think I fully realized that one's life after conversion would inevitably consist in doing most of the same things one had been doing before. One hopes in a new spirit, but still the same things. Christianity does not exclude any of the ordinary human activities. St. Paul tells people to get on with their jobs. He even assumes that Christians may go to dinner parties, and what's more, dinner parties given by pagans. Our Lord attends a wedding and provides miraculous wine, and under the aegis of his church, and in the most Christian ages, learning and the arts flourish. The solution of this paradox is, of course, well known to you, whether you eat or drink or whatever you do to alter the glory of God. All our merely natural activities will be accepted if they are offered to God, even the humblest. And all of them, even the noblest, will be sinful if they're not. Christianity does not simply replace our natural life and substitute a new one. It is rather a new organization which exploits to its own supernatural ends these natural materials. There's no essential quarrel between the spiritual life and human activities as such." End quote. And thus we encounter Lewis making the paradoxical point about learning being done for its own sake, which is to the glory of God, without thereby bending the research to come to edifying conclusions or to show its relevance somehow to Christian life. Quote, "By leading that learned life to the glory of God, I do not, of course, mean any attempt to make our intellectual inquiries work out to edifying conclusions. I mean the pursuit of knowledge and beauty, in a sense for their own sake, but in a sense which does not exclude their being for God's sake." End quote. In fact, Lewis sharpens the point of the value of our work as intrinsic rather than instrumental. Quote, "I do not mean that a Christian should take money for supplying one thing, culture, and use the opportunity thus gained to supply a quite different thing, homiletics, apologetics, or evangelism. That, he says, is stealing." Unquote. So the point for everyone is that if even the relatively rarefied activity of advanced scholarship is justified, all the more are more practical activities thereby justified. Child rearing, business, health care, and so on. And Lewis knew about some of these things too, as we shall now see. Work and domesticity. A.N. Wilson's biography of Lewis is almost certainly the least favorite biography among Lewis fans, and understandably reviled by their number for its sarcasm and its cheap Freudian speculation. Yet, Wilson's depiction of Lewis running from his endless territorial sessions with more or less motivated Oxford undergraduates to pick up groceries on his way out to the kilns, and the demanding, we would even say dysfunctional, quasi-family he maintained with the odd Mrs. Moore, her apparently normal daughter, and his alcoholic brother. This was a truly domestic Lewis. Right? Lewis wasn't existing in some kind of happy Neverland where he would go for strolls with Tolkien on Addison's Walk and then have the scouts clean his rooms only to prepare a nice supper for him of an evening when he had beautiful thoughts to share with the world. This was a guy constantly on the run. And as I finished Wilson's biography, I thought Lewis's star shone all the brighter in my mind as I thought, he wrote all that in the real world, not in some misty Oxonian Neverland. In fact, one of Lewis's former Oxford students remarks, most of the time that I was an undergraduate, he went home to his house in Headington in the evenings, though I think he spent all his days in college. He once said how irritating it was that one seemed to get one's best ideas with both hands in hot water during the washing up, unable to make notes. One of my friends after the war expressed his regret at his own lack of domesticity, and Lewis said, ah, you have too little of it and I have too much. In fact, C.S. Lewis, and there in fact are the sainted sinks in which he did those dishes, a place of pilgrimage indeed. Lewis was indeed a common man as well as an uncommon scholar. But he did not simply fly back and forth between university and family. He enjoyed, as some of you know, extended walking tours with male friends, and occasionally female companions joined the company as well. And these trips featured friendship, beer and food, conversation, and encounter with nature, all of which Lewis esteemed highly. Quote, my happiest hours are spent with three or four old friends in old clothes, tramping together and putting up in small pubs, or else sitting up until the small hours in someone's college rooms, talking nonsense, poetry, theology, and metaphysics over beer, tea, and pipes, end quote. I remark on these trips because Lewis undertook them gladly and was sorry whenever one would have to be canceled because of a crisis. He never saw these extended outings as somehow taking away from either his family duties or his scholarly vocation. Still, his scholarly vocation occupied most of his waking hours, and we can learn much from him on this score as well, no matter our own occupations. The primary thing I want us to notice tonight, perhaps, is that upon his conversion, Lewis didn't leave Oxford and the teaching of literature for a divinity college career or a preaching ministry. Despite his status as the 20th century's most influential apologist, such work was a sideline for him, and he seems never to have considered seriously either a church career or a job in academic theological training. Nor do any of Lewis's biographers that I've read indicate that someone ever suggested he do so. In Lewis's world, devotion to literature hundreds of years old was a perfectly worthy thing for a Christian to do. Indeed, despite Lewis's own writing that implies a hierarchy of activities for the Christian with evangelism at its putative peak, for all of his evangelistic talents, he seems never to have considered an evangelistic career. His practice was to carry on the work God had already called him to do, and to which he was obviously well suited. As Wesley Court nicely puts it, quote, Lewis does not respond to the cultural despisers of religion by becoming a religious despiser of culture, unquote. Furthermore, the very Christian life he was articulating is a life that prizes literature and encourages its study by those gifted in such scholarship. The kingdom of God includes the enjoyment of literature, and any proper evangelism points to that fact of the kingdom. So Lewis literally lived out his evangel by continuing his scholarship, as well as in his more explicitly religious writings. Indeed, those many, many fans of Lewis's fiction, from Screwtape to The Great Divorce to Till We Have Faces to the Ransom Trilogy to Narnia, need to consider that this eminent scholar and equally eminent apologist was taking considerable time away from both of those respectable vocations to write stories. Lewis's easy transition from one type of writing to another demonstrates his wide vision for what counts as worthwhile work in the world. And thus Lewis counsels us to do what we know we are to do. We are on the stage, he says. To play well the scenes in which we are on concerns us much more than to guess about the scenes that follow. Unquote. We do, to be sure, have some sense of the final act of the drama. And Lewis says, quote, what is important is not that we should always fear or hope about the end, but that we should always remember, always take the end into account. For, he says, what comes eventually is judgment. And happy are those whom it finds laboring in their vocations, whether they were merely going out to feed the pigs or laying good plans to deliver humanity 100 years hence from some great evil. The curtain has indeed now fallen. Those pigs will never, in fact, be fed. The great campaign against white slavery or governmental tyranny will never, in fact, proceed to victory. No matter. You were at your post when the inspection came. Unquote. Enjoying the world, then, and its maker. Lewis's brother, Warney, tells of him encountering a tramp while on a country walk. Finding the fellow had some appreciation for poetry, Lewis asked the man to wait. He hurried home and returned with a twofold gift, a book of collected verse and several bottles of beer. As Richard Pertle sums up, quote, the combined gift from Lewis's own library and larder seems to strike just the right note of human comradeship. And to be sure, this scene might strike us as being as far removed from our own experience as Lewis's beloved Middle Ages themselves. Who among us has a book of poetry to give away, as well as bottles of beer? For C.S. Lewis, beer and poetry are intrinsically good. God pronounced the creation good in Genesis 1 with no hint that it was good only because it somehow pointed back to God, and I think the Lewis biographies, as well as his own writings, indicate that he was not, in fact, forever thinking to himself, I enjoyed this friend's company because he reminds me of God, or I enjoyed this pint of bitter because it reminds me of God, and so on. Now, Lewis sometimes overstates things in his love of the powerful image, and thus he can diminish what is good while he's trying to praise what is better. Recall the famous passage in his sermon, The Weight of Glory, in which he contrasts human life without salvation as the child's mud pies versus a holiday at the sea, or the well-known depiction of the incarnation in Mere Christianity as a human being becoming a slug or a crab. Each of these analogies, it seems to me, overdoes things, because the mud pies are not intrinsically good, and the slug or crab does not in any obvious way bear the image of the maker. So we too must beware of metaphors that underplay the God-given goodness of things. The key instead seems to be to delight in things without inordinate love and enjoying all of life to the praise of its giver, God. In conclusion, it's in the Narnia tales that Lewis perhaps illustrates best his fundamental understanding, both Christian and indeed more than a little Platonic, of how this world relates to the next. So in the spirit of both Christian and ancient Greek teleology, let's look at the last things, indeed at the last battle. Lewis depicts the best of Narnia and the best of England as both residing within Aslan's country. Lewis says that Aslan invites us not to despise them, but to mount up from them, to go farther up and farther in. Narnia itself is destroyed finally by water and then frozen, its sun extinguished and then dismissed, its cosmic role accomplished. Yet those who are on Aslan's side continue in a land very much like Narnia, only better, green, vital, and good. Our heroes then arrive at a splendid walled garden, and the main character, Lucy, begins to see the way things really are. The old Narnia was a shadow or copy of the real one. Quoting now, Lucy looked hard at the garden and saw that it was not really a garden at all, but a whole world, with its own rivers and woods and sea and mountains. But they were not strange. She knew them all. "I see," she said. "This is still Narnia, and more real and more beautiful than the Narnia down below, just as it was more real and more beautiful than the Narnia outside the stable door. I see, world within world, Narnia within Narnia." "Yes," said Mr. Tumnus, "like an onion, except that as you go in and in, each circle is larger than the last." Then Lucy spots what she recognizes as England, and the faun explains, "But you're now looking at the England within England, the real England, just as this is the real Narnia. And in that inner England, no good thing is destroyed." Then the children see their dead parents walking toward them, smiling and waving, very much alive. And the faun again explains, "That country of the dead and this country, all the real countries, are only spurs jutting out from the great mountains of Aslan. We have only to walk along the ridge, upward and inward, till it joins on." And thus Aslan himself pronounces, "The term is over, the holidays have begun, the dream is ended. This is the morning." And Lewis's narrator concludes, "But for them, it was only the beginning of the real story. All their life in this world and all their adventures in Narnia had only been the cover and the title page. And now at last they were beginning chapter one of the great story which no one on earth has read, which goes on forever, in which every chapter is better than the one before." Thanks for your attention. So we have time for a few comments, harsh denunciations, personal attacks. It's all welcome. Yes, yes, please, young man at the back, young fellow. Everybody hear the question okay?
No.
Good, because I can make it easier for myself. So I'm being asked what my favorite color is, and it's blue. Thank you very kindly. Another question. The question has to do with politics and the intrinsic goodness of politics. And Lewis seems not to see an intrinsic goodness of politics. He seems instead to see it as a kind of necessary evil almost, a kind of restraining of badness. But seems to see his understanding of cultural flourishing in other spheres, but not politics itself. Whereas in Aristotle and others, there's a sense in which this is an important part of being a human being, a full-fledged human being, is to engage in political life, being a citizen and a member of the polis, per se. I summarized it okay? Well, I think you're right, and that is what I'm intimating, is that it seems to me that on the one hand, Lewis puts it in terms of a kind of role differentiation. You know, I'm a scholar of literature, you might happen to be a politician. Who am I to suggest what the great political problems of our time should resolve in? That's your kind of thing, that's what you should do. And to that extent, I think it's very helpful to say different people are gifted in different ways, and we should recognize each other's expertise rather than thinking that we're all equally good at everything. So I think it's a really powerful word to say today when it comes to politics and religion, the two, to me, most complicated of human endeavors, and the two areas in which everybody thinks they're as expert as everybody else. So in that respect, I want to underline Lewis's appropriate sense of deference to those who actually knew more than he did about economics, politics, and so on. At the same time, I think you're also picking up from me, my sense is that Lewis seems to me to be deeply alienated from the political process. He seems to really have no sense of even what an average citizen should do. Now, I haven't read all of Lewis's huge corpus, but I've read quite a bit of it, and I don't remember him ever saying, here's what a Christian citizen should do when it comes to election time, or when it comes to local politics and supporting local people and local initiatives and so on. His mind just doesn't seem to turn very much to that. And I've wondered about that. I've wondered if part of that is the fact that he comes from among the most alienated parts of the British Empire at the time, Northern Ireland. I wonder if it's because he suffered over and over again at the hands of Oxford University politics, continually being turned down for chairs and other honors that finally he had to leave Oxford to gain at Cambridge. I've wondered if the kind of hassle he got from the powers that be, especially when his apologetics and his fiction became popular, made him feel that he was really not part of the inner ring, part of that circle. And that kind of alienation may have been a kind of a coping mechanism to be as healthful and as helpful as he could be, given what he felt to be his limited but fruitful opportunities for service. I can only guess about that, given the little bit I know about his life. But personally, I felt that Lewis was really helpful as far as he goes, but I personally had to turn to other people like Reinhold Niebuhr and Dietrich Bonhoeffer and others if I wanted to think about how to be political in the world, because I find Lewis to be almost useless in that regard. Yeah. Please.
So you said that in some instances you felt like Lewis went too far in kind of minimizing some goods for the maximization of greater good in his view. You were saying an example of the mud ties compared to the holiday at sea. Mm-hmm. Do you think that's just a fault of language, or do you think that was really Lewis's kind of issue? Do you think it was just something he had to do in order to make his point, or are you saying that he actually believed that it was different?
So I'm being asked about Lewis's metaphors, including some of the ones I talked about with the mud pies and the slug or the crab, and where's the problem there? I don't know, and I think it's very risky for me to suggest that Lewis's figures got away from him, but I am suggesting that they did, because it doesn't seem to be consistent with other things that he says more straightforwardly. And I wonder if in trying to come up with a kind of vivid everyday example that a whole radio audience could respond to, he picks those kinds of metaphors, which occur to lots of other people as well, right? Would he devote that sacred head for such a worm as I, right? It's not Lewis alone that does fall into what I think is the trap of poetically overstating the glory of God by denigrating the image of God. And I've heard many a preacher who's decided that the best way to praise God is to insult his creation. And I think that's probably a bad strategy and really unbiblical. So it seems to me Lewis, my best guess is that he actually just it gets away from him a little bit and could be tempered in a way that would make the image perhaps less powerful but also more accurate. Yeah. Yes, sir.
You mentioned at the beginning that he and Tolkien
Well, firstly, I'm very glad to tell you that I didn't say that. He did. And the biographers wonder about that. They were good friends, it seems, in the 20s. And then the end of the 30s, that starts to cool. And then in the 40s and 50s, quite cooled off. And we can all guess. I mean, I don't recall anybody that I've read looking at extensive archival work and saying, here's where Lewis told us why he was. I mean, it seems to actually, my sense is, though, it seems to be asymmetrical. It seems that Tolkien cooled on Lewis more than Lewis cooled on Tolkien, frankly. Lewis continued to admire Tolkien in a way that Tolkien didn't admire Lewis's. Sorry, Lewis admired Tolkien's work in a way that Tolkien didn't admire Lewis's. And I suppose you could sustain a friendship under those circumstances. That'd be hard, right? If one of your best friends, who's somebody you admire, just keeps not liking what you do as your life's work. So that may be all the explanation there needs to be. And others have suggested that Tolkien was envious of Lewis in some ways. People are complex, but I'm not a psychologist and I don't know well enough to know for sure. But maybe you know. Yeah, it's funny. I don't know about that. If that's true, it's kind of funny because they're both right. I mean, if you're a Catholic, you are a papist. You know, it's not usually meant as a loving thing for a Protestant to say, but I mean, you are. And when it comes to Lewis's relationship with Joy, which was initially kept secret for months, and then finally, that is a weird marriage, you know? So they're both right. I mean, as I show you, I am completely useless when it comes to the mysteries of human relationships. So let's press on to something else I can talk about instead. But thank you. Yes. If Lewis ever talked very much about the church, I don't know about it. One of the points I try to make along the way is that he seems to, and a lot of his friends confirm, he seems to have written very little about the church and reflected very little about it. Now, Lewis, as Professor Ward suggested, probably when he was here and also in his book, Lewis was an unusual cat. I mean, among the many ways he was unusual was the compartmentalization and the layering of his life, as well as his writings. And so the mere fact that he doesn't talk about X, I have to be careful, doesn't mean he didn't think about it or didn't matter to him. He was pretty good at segmenting things in a way that other people who write as much as he did, you'd think would talk about these things eventually. So we're arguing largely from silence. But even in the few depictions he does have of going to church, he seems to have been an unusually sensitive person, which a lot of creatives are. And their kind of personal psychological filters are low, and they're constantly irritated. And when Lewis writes in Mere Christianity and elsewhere about the squeak of the old shoe and the guy clearing his throat in the next pew and this person kind of scrubbing their, like all these distractions at church, you think, man, you need to take more medication. But it strikes me as a sensitive person, as Lewis would have been, just being bugged by all these things that other people kind of just shrug and put up with. So it's difficult to know from that. What did he think about going to church? What did he think about the church? What did he think about the priesthood as representatives of Christ? Or are they just preachers? We don't know. I mean, as far as I know, he never did write very much about it. And it seems to me that Lewis may well have been someone who really did take Holy Communion seriously, but may not have been very involved in his church. I don't know of any evidence that he was a churchman the way we would talk about somebody involved in his local church today. I don't know for sure, but my guess is that he may well have believed, as lots of Christians do who aren't Catholics, in the sense that in the Eucharist, Christ is truly present. If we put it that way, that takes in most Christians, Catholic, Orthodox, Lutheran, and Calvinists, if they follow Calvin on spiritual presence, that there's something more than mere symbolism there. So it's entirely consistent with Lewis's outlook that he would have thought that. My guess is, not being particularly committed to Aristotelian metaphysics, he might not have committed to transubstantiation per se, but his belief that Jesus really meets us in the Lord's Supper, I would bet that he believed that. Yeah. Time for one or two more, and then we'll let you get on your way, but happy to visit with you a little longer if you've got a question or two.
He does give his opinion on Holy Communion in letters to Malcolm.
Mm-hmm. And? Yes. Yes, thank you. So a couple places where he does talk about it, and I just was too lazy to remember them. But thank you. These guys have helped me. Well, very good. Let me have you come on up and do whatever you need to do now. Thank you for listening.